Hello everybody, and welcome back once again to Let's Play Motorsport Manager with the Phoenix Knights Racing Team. Here we are, it's going to be race number 9 in 24 days at Milan for the Italian Grand Prix. And in the last session, Valdez continues his fight back. He got race victory in, was it Portugal? I think it was Portugal. I'll get there eventually. It was Portugal. Yes, it was. It was Portugal. He got the race victory whilst Sundin got third place, which means he's gained a further 6 points on her in the championship. With 3 races to go, it's not completely game over just yet. So, as you can see, we've got 24 days until the next race. So I'm going to do the pre-race stuff on camera again. So the first thing that I'm actually going to do today is I'm going to take a look at the rules in the Asia Pacific Cup, because that might just determine how I prepare the car for next season. Let's take a look, shall we? How do we get there then, is the question. Teams? No, there's a way to get to this and I completely have forgotten, so you'll have to bear with me. In the meantime, I've just woken up literally about 15 minutes ago, so if my voice is a bit croaky, that could be why. Here we go. I'm going out in about an hour and a half, so I'm trying to squeeze this session in before I go. Gotta have my breakfast first, so there may be some interruptions. I'll try and fit it in when I'm doing the practice, so that you're not going to get any sort of pauses into the action. So here we are, Asia Pacific Cup. This is the current rule set. We don't know what's going to be passing next season, I don't think. But at least we can see the current rule set. So, medium length practice sessions. So the practice session lengths are a little bit longer than what we have now. As are the qualifying lengths. So that's good to know. We've got a bit more time to do some laps in qualifying and time to set the car up in practice, which I suppose is good. I think it's the same average race length, or is it a little bit longer? I think we've got short at the moment, so this is a touch longer race length as well. The pit lane speed limit is faster, but we still have the same 6-man pit crew for the slow pit stops. High merit payments, that's quite interesting. There's a large difference in prize money between the top and bottom of the bottom teams. So teams finishing top get much more prize money, which is not going to help us out to start with, because we're not going to be one of the good teams in the series. Points for the top 6 like we've got now. Double points for the final race of the season. I hate that. Bonus points for fastest lap and bonus points for pole position. Low profile tyres. Compounds are decided before the race. You get 2 dry tire compounds. We get 3 now, but I've been used to having 2 in the past. 12 choices for 12 tires per race weekend. Virtual safety car rather than the physical safety car. And we can use driver aids. Now, I've never ever used driver aids. Never. I don't even know how to do it. So can you develop those for your car? How does that work? I'll have to see how that works. We can't develop our engines, so this will affect how we develop our car for next season. We can qualify Brutus tyres, and it's the same fuel tank, 40% race distance. Next year, we can see next year's rules. They're going to add the Black Sea to the calendar, and they're actually going to make those fuel tanks bigger. So the fuel tanks can last up to 80% of race distance rather than 40. So only 1 fuel stop per race is required. That could be worth bearing in mind for how we set the car up. So in terms of setting our car up for next season, then we're not going to develop our engine any further because there's no point. We get stock engines next season. And also, when we design our chassis for next season, normally I don't focus on fuel efficiency so much, but with the extra fuel tank size, having better fuel efficiency might just help us out a little touch. So we might focus a bit more on fuel efficiency next season. So yeah, that's kind of interesting to see. thought I'd show you that on camera, so how we're going to prepare our car for next season. So how we are going to prepare our car for next season, and what I usually do at around about this time in the season is we start to develop components and parts that are illegal to use this season. As we pick a new sponsor, third or above, which is better? This is actually slight, by my calculation, 600 grand. Yeah, this is slightly better by about 200 grand over the six races. So yeah, we're going to take that one. And it's got a nice upfront payment as well, just in case we don't hit our bonus for finishing third all the time, which we don't usually, for qualifying particularly. Right, we'll move on. Car repair's complete, so we'll pause it and sort the car out. I'll explain about how I'm going to develop the car for next season when we get the part ready. Right, so next race is in Milan, which is engine and brakes and rear wing in terms of reliability. And also, before we go any further, just going to double check how we've got the car set up, because I got a feeling that Valdez might have the better car now, which, you know, it's good for him, but I want to make sure they've got an even car as best as possible. So brakes, Valdez has the better brakes by about, 40 points? So he's about 40 points ahead. He has the better engine, which means he's a further fit. So he's about 90 points of performance ahead. Sund in there, that's 60. That's almost 70. So Valdez is about 20 points ahead. And Sund has got the better car. She's got a further 50 points there, so she's actually ahead. She has the better car by about 30 points of performance overall. She's actually not fair. So I'm actually going to switch. I'm going to switcheroo this a little bit. I'm going to give Valdez the better. That's what you see. But he gets the better. That's going to come good. When the performance levels go up, but they're not there yet, so we're just gonna switcheroo this a touch, I think. So let me think this through here. That's 20, 40 points there, 50 points there. I'm gonna do that, give him the better suspension, but then give Sundin the better brake, so that'll just close 10 points of performance there. So she still has a better car for now, until his gearbox improves, but it just closes that gap. Right, lovely. Okay, folks, sorry about that. Had to just pop downstairs, grab a bit of breakfast. That's the first interruption of probably many, I do apologise. It's going to be one of those sessions, I think. Right, okay, so I have forwarded the time a little smidgen. I don't have a lot of time to play with, so I can't go through everything in massive detail. But what I've done is that the suspension has now been built that we were waiting for. I've plopped that down. Where the hell am I? I've given that new suspension to Valdez because it's slightly worse at the moment, but it will become better. It will become better in time. Now, he's unhappy with the state of his car now, because his car is a little bit worse than Sundin's by about 20, I think about 20 performance points or so. But the thing is, due to how the parts are spread, there's no possible way that we're going to give him an even car. One of them are going to have an inferior car. And given the choice of the two, I'm going with Sundin to have the better car. She's more stable, she's more calm. He's kicking off all the time, so he's shot himself in the foot, really. So he's got a slightly inferior car for now. It will come good and even out when he gets the benefit of his extra performance from the suspension. But that could take a bit of time. So we're sorting out the performance levels of all the parts now and of the reliability as best we can. So that is the car for this season. So in terms of the car for next season then, well, what I'm going to do is I'm going to now start designing the best possible part, gearbox, brakes and suspension, that I can. And even if that involves using risky parts. Now, let's see how this works then. So risky parts, of course, you can use them, but there's a risk to using them. during the current season that you're in. They could get banned if they find you using them. But they often offer the best boost to performance. Now, the way I like to think of it from a roleplay perspective, rather than a bit of a gamey kind of thing to do, is that I think of it like they are developing a part that is pushing the boundaries of the rules, and they can't use them for this season because they're they are illegal. But next season, when they carry forward the performance level, you know, they've had extra time pre-season to refine that part and fit it in to the rule set. So, that's the way I look at it. They're kind of just sort of pushing the boundaries, trying new things, and then they refine that for the next season and get it legal. That's how I like to think of it. So in terms of building the best possible part for this car, it's built of that, that, and that. 270-408. So once that's built, that will then be maxed out. We'll max out the performance as quickly as possible. Won't use it for this season, but it hopefully will carry forward next season and give us a better gearbox. So we'll build that now. Oh, we've got an empty component slot. Holy cow. Let's go for that as well then. Wow, an epic part we are creating here. I didn't even realize we had another slot to use. 270-448. Even better. Even better indeed. Lovely. That's going to be a kick-ass gearbox. Although, when we get promoted, it's probably going to be still the worst gearbox on the grid. Okay, so that's the gearbox that we are now focusing on for next season. As I said, suspension and brakes, no engine. Because engines are stock. As we now power forward to the fact now that our forecasting center is built, so we can now plan better in the race because we can see further along for the weather condition changes, which is absolutely great. We can make better strategic moves, so that's going to help us. And we're not going to build anything else now. We're going to save this money now until we get promoted, because I want to be able to design a really good chassis for next season to give us a helping hand in the new series. I also want to focus heavily on developing parts as quickly as possible, which is going to cost a bit of cash, and I just want to, you know, just want to have some money to play with whilst we judge how best to spend it in the new series. So we're going to hold off now building any further buildings for now. Sponsor, we've done sponsors. I think everything else is pretty much sorted, so we'll power on to the race. Power on to the race. What's going on here? Not much powering going on here. Stop. It's a bit stop-start. There we go. Another race and another series that we're not interested about. It's the World Motorsport Championship in Vancouver. Canadian Grand Prix. Very good. Very good. Right. Keep moving. Here we are. Go. Here we go. Antonov is now hated by his own mechanics, in addition to El Sadat being hated by his. All of these are our nearest rivals. This is good to see. Discontent amongst the ranks of our fellow rivals helps us out immensely. Right, we're going to be voting for front wing development next season. We're not going to be here, so we're going to save our vote. And car's ready. The car is ready as well as it's going to be ready. Performance levels have been increased. I think we're now going to max out the performance levels as much as possible. I think our reliability for this car now is pretty much spot on, so we'll try and power through the performance increases. So third best engine, 6th best accelerations, 9th best brakes, and 4th best suspension. We will be making no more advancements to this season's car. It's all about next season now. Right, practice session, as per usual. I'll do it off camera. I'll manage to just chow down my breakfast, and then we'll be ready for qualifying. Okay, folks, hello and welcome back. I've had my breakfast, I've had my cup of tea, and now I'm ready for qualifying. So, apparently if you click the screen and drag it, it stops that bloody whole situation with the scrolling. So thank you to a couple of people that highlighted that for me. Annoys the hell out of me. Only temporarily stops it though, but it just gives you a nice time to look at things, you know. So Valdez 5th and Sundin's 7th in the practice. We usually top the sheets, but not today, which fills me with a bit of dread. Coming up to qualifying in the race. So yeah, and some fan has got tickets for a tour around our headquarters. We always welcome fans. So this is where we might have a slight advantage now. We have the forecasting centre, so we can plan our strategies much more efficiently. Which is saying something, because good old Potter has planned his strategies very well so far. But we can certainly see further into the session here. What we can see is that it's going to rain very heavily to start with, but then the track's going to dry. So we're going to wait. We are going to wait. Now, I don't think we're going to have to. I don't think we're going to get soft tyre use, but it's the only thing we can use at the moment, so we'll have to use it. Setups have been done. Valdez has the better setup. He's pushing hard, I'm telling you. He's pushing hard. He's setting his car up as perfectly as possible. He is trying his level best. Can't say he's not a fighter. Right, I'm going to fold the time because the track is going to dry. Is it going to give us enough time to do a completely dry lap, or will it be a lap on inters? I don't know, but the other cars are delaying their flying laps. But they're going out. They're probably going to be doing their hot laps when the track is still round about there, which means it's still going to be sopping wet through, but the track is going to go completely and utterly bone dry with about 3 minutes to go. So I'm going to send my drivers out on completely dry tyres. So I'm just going to wait. People doing laps on wet, people doing laps on inters. Maybe they don't have the forecasting centre and can't see quite as far ahead as we can, but we know it's going to dry, so we're not going to panic at the moment. Not going to panic. Just going to wait until about 3 minutes left. Well, in fact, we're going to wait till about maybe 2.5 minutes left and send the guys out. This is a very similar strategy to the last session, where we're going to blitz a completely dry time whilst everybody is probably still messing around or in the pits even when it comes to the track being at its peak condition. Still plenty of time left here. I'm not going to send it. Track is now getting completely dry. We're going to see if anybody's going out. Nobody's doing an outlap at the moment. Now what we don't want to happen is we don't want to be stuck behind cars doing something similar. So we're going to send them out now. We're going to send them out on the softest tyre possible. But we have a nice healthy bonus. Going to send Valdez out as well, roughly at the same time. So we're going to do our time now. Not as late as we sometimes do go out, but we're not going to risk it completely. We don't have to go so risky, because everybody is looking like this. Going to struggle to get a dry time. Liao's coming out, I think. Is Liao coming out? Himsov? They're on outlaps, so we might have a few cars to battle for pole position. But not everybody is coming out, I don't think. Okay, we've got a few. Maybe they're learning. Maybe they're learning from their past mistakes. Right. So we'll follow Valdez today. He's the man on the charge. He's the man pushing hard to try and catch Sundin in the championships. He's the man that has the rivalry with her. Something's going to ry there, we know. Secret liaisons gonna miss, perhaps. Valdez has got the good tyre temperatures, the good brakes. Sundin has screwed up her brake temperatures. So Valdez has potential here to out-qualify Sundin if all goes according to plan. Neither car has traffic ahead of them, so this is a good opportunity to put in a very fast lap. Here we go. Sundin is 4.7 seconds faster than the fastest time. We know the fastest time has been set on intermediates, so we're just setting the benchmark. Valdez is 4.8. He's a tenth up on Sundin at this moment in time. He is really pushing hard. Sundin 9.1 seconds ahead of the fastest time at the second sector. Valdez 9.3. He's 2 tenths up by the second sector. He's looking like he's going to out-qualify Sundin, and we know he has that race trait where he's a good racer. Here we go, Valdez, 2.26 seconds faster than Sundin. But look at that, Heemsoff, he squeaks into pole position by 0.01. Can you believe it? We've been denied a 1-2 by Vexala. Well done, Heemsoff. Looks like the Heemsoff team have been taking tips from Brian Potter on how to execute during qualifying. God bless them. Right, okay, so it's a 2-3. A 2-3 for Phoenix Knights, which A, gets us our sponsorship target, and B, puts us in a good position for the race. Our nearest rivals, Ruiz Motorsport, Antonov down in 9th, and Mikhailovich down in 14th. Where's Sabado? Sabado in... The Firebird really don't do well in variable qualifying. This is the second race in a row they've qualified all the way down here. And where's El Sadat? He's 10th. So our nearest rivals are nowhere near us. Nowhere near us at all. This could be ominous for the race. Could be ominous for our competitors. Can it be another clean sweep by Phoenix Knights? Let's hope so. So let's have a look at the race conditions. It's cloudy with a bit of sun, but is the rain going to come? And if so, when? Let's have a look. It's coming round about lap 5. A sprinkling of rain, potentially round about lap 5. So what we're going to do is we're not going to short fuel, because we're going to long fuel it to lap 5 and assess the situation. So if we didn't see that far ahead, my normal strategy is to short fuel one of them, especially in a race like this where we can afford to do that. But there's no benefit to short fueling now, considering that the rain is coming round about lap 5, so we've got to get to at least lap 5 so that we can assess the situation. Right, so we're going to use the softest tyre, we're going to max the fuel loads for both cars, and see what happens here. We're going to have to play this as defensive as possible. See how long the rain comes for, how heavy it's going to be before we decide what we're going to do. So we're just going to completely play this by ear. Put both drivers on exactly the same strategy, but we're not going to double stack them. But we will see. We will see what happens. Okay, that's fine. The temperatures are pretty low, so we're going to absolutely push the hell out of the tyres to get some heat into them. And that's pretty much it. Fingers crossed! Is Valdez going to beat Sundin for the third race in a row? So we've seen the grid. Heemsoff in pole, Valdez second, Sundin third, Masilela in the second Vexala. So Vexala both having a real good qualifying. Looks like they know how to do strategy in their team. And then we've got Hong Liao back up in fifth place with Dragon Race Team China. Predator Racing up in sixth position, having a great session there. But Gerard in the Firebird in seventh, and another Dragon Race Team China up in eighth. Really good session for their team. Ruiz Motorsport down in ninth, very disappointing for them. Zampelli, El Sadat in tenth. So here we are, the lights are on, and we're about to get underway here in Italy. It's... go, go, go! As Valdez, as per usual, gets a flying start. He's passed the man in Vexala, Heemsoff, already into the first corner, and he's put his foot down. He ain't messing around today, folks. He is continuing that charge, as Sundin is now down into fifth position. Her start, well, not quite so marvellous. I'm kind of rooting for Valdez here. I'm rooting for the underdog. I mean, I do like Sundin. She's very calm, very smooth, very quick. But Valdez, just something about Valdez, his temperament, you know, you just got to root for an underdog. Got to root for an underdog here, as he's putting his foot well and truly down. We've got to be careful, though. And I'll tell you why we've got to be careful. It's we've got to stretch this stint out, because we need to judge how much fuel we're going to need. You know what, we can afford to go high. I'm not going to go completely and utterly... normal. We need to push. We need to push a little bit. But yeah, we need to conserve as much fuel as possible, so that we can get as far as possible to stretch the dry tire stint. It is going to rain, and the rain is going to come for a bit of time. It's going to go at least to intermediate levels, and it's going to come for long enough for us to make a proper stint out of it. We'll keep an eye on that as we progress forward, as Valdez is just controlling the pace of this race from the front. I mean, this past three races has shown the true champion that he really is. It has shown. We're going to push his engine now. He's got plenty of fuel left over, as has Sundin, so we'll push them both. Yeah, it's shown his true colours, really. As two cars have crashed out. I mean, if we had a safety car, that would probably ruin us a little bit. But it's not a safety car, it's just a yellow flag as Valdez continues to pump blistering sectors in. He is absolutely going for this. Yeah, the past three races, he's shown his true colours as a champion. He's not gone down without a fight. He knows he has to push hard and to catch Sundin. And he's really doing it. And he's doing it with the worst car. Sundin has the slightly better car here, and he is absolutely putting it to the sword at the moment. Putting her to the sword. Right. I'm just going to turn that down now. We've got a big enough gap from Valdez to Sundin to bring them both in on the same lap. So it's not a problem there. But we're just going to... I mean, we're just following Valdez driving around the track at the moment. Not very exciting, but I'm enjoying it. I'm enjoying watching him dominate this race. Let's have a look at Sundin. Let's have a wee look here. She is in fourth. Is she gaining on her the cars ahead of her? I think she's playing it by ear. I think she's relying on our strategy superiority to shine through and pass a few cars. Right, Valdez, let's have a look as he crosses the line. He has 1.16 laps of fuel in the bag. So we're going to just keep him on high for half of this lap. The track is still dry and he has to come in now, which is a bit of a shame because it's one lap earlier than I really anticipated, but we can't help that. We're going to have to do some of our stint when the track isn't quite wet, but we're going to max fuel it. Oh, I forgot I put the new suspension on his car and it wasn't ready. No. Oh, no. No. I completely and utterly forgot to focus on the new suspension, on the reliability. Oh, no. That is so crap. Oh man, I'm really absolutely fuming here. Absolutely fuming. He's gonna have to fix that before the end of the race. He does have time in hand though. Oh, if Sundin beats him because of that, I'm gonna be flipping mortified. Absolutely mortified. Right, she's coming in as well. She's gonna max out the stop. Oh, that is crap. Absolute crap. The team have screwed him again. So this is the second time the team have screwed him. Last time we were in Milan, he missed his pit stop, remember, last time we were here. And now he's got a dodgy bloody suspension. And Sundin has passed the car. She's passed Gerrard. She's into third position. So she's just doing things that she needs to do. She knows that she doesn't have to win the races. She's not going to risk anything, pushing too hard and flying off the track. She's just taking things as they come, doing it in her usual calm style. Valdez is putting his foot down, which is what he has to do. Oh, we're getting very close to the fuel boundaries here for both drivers. I'm going to have to put it on low. We're going to run out of fuel just as we're crossing the damn line. Holy cow. We really are living life on the edge today, aren't we, folks? Right, Valdez's pit. Oh, there's a mistake as well. There's a mistake. And it's backed Sundin up as well. Oh, it's all going wrong. Look at that, we should have been out ahead of Heemsoff. We're now going out side by side. Valdez's lead has been diminished due to the pit stop. Right, we can't afford to push too hard here. How many laps? We've got to go until lap 10. Oh, it's going to stay intermediate for the rest of the race by the looks of it. I don't believe this. Do not believe it. Right, ignore what he's saying. Oh, have we just chucked this race away? Here comes the rain. This is exactly what we expected to happen, but everybody else has anticipated this happening as well. Sundin. Forgot to put her back up into the bloody right engine mode. I am absolutely having a nightmare today. I'm having a nightmare. She is in 7th position. How? Oh, because she double stacked. She double stacked due to the mistake from Valdez's pit crew. That's completely scuppered her chances. This race has gone to the dogs, I'm afraid to have to say. Completely and utterly gone to the dogs. Right. And now Valdez is going to have to fix his suspension in the next stop, which is going to completely and utterly screw him even further. I think his chances of race victory have just slipped away here. I think they have completely slipped away as Heemsoth, what is he doing? He's pushing and pushing. I was trying to eke out the fuel, but now that I can see that we're going to be on intermediates for the rest of the race, there's no point of eking out any fuel. We might as well push as hard as we can for as long as we can. This is critical. This is absolutely race critical here. As Valdez, 2.2 seconds behind Heemsoth, but he is gaining now as we push. Heemsoth is now going normal mode. There's no such normal mode luxuries here. Valdez is going to have to push hard for the most of this race. He's going to have to go for it. 26% on the suspension. He's going to have to fix it in the next stop. So he's going to have to try and pass him and build some kind of a gap. Come on. Come on, Valdez. Come on. Sundin, she's pushing. She's in 7th place. She's out of the points at the moment. This could be, even though if he doesn't win the race, Valdez, he's still gaining a fair chunk of points at this moment in time. There he is, he's gaining, he's pushing hard. He is pushing extremely hard here. As look at this, some defensive driving from Heemsoth, who has never won a race. He's coming into the pits already. He is coming into the pits. Now, are they going to put on intermediates? Or are they going to put on full wets? Let's have a look what they do. Full wets are going to be a mistake at this point. And he's now pushing the tyres, but conserving the fuel. There's no such conserving going on here. We are absolutely pedal to the metal. Come on, Valdez. Come on, lad. You can do it, Captain. I'm kind of worried and wondered if we... There we go. He's got a lap of clear air now. He has to make this lap count. He's going to come in to the pits. He's going to put another set of mediums on. He's going to fuel to the end. And he has to fix the part. He has to. It's going to... 8 seconds. 8 seconds. Do we risk it? We're going to risk it with him. We're going to risk it. He's ordered his pit crew to pull out all the stops here. There is no... But dressing this up, he has to take that chance. He needs to take that risk. The race depends on it. So here we go. Valdez coming up to his second and final stop. It is going to be a slower one. He has to fix some parts. The pit crew taking a risk. Taking a risk to try and eke out every last second. As he speeds around the chicane to manoeuvre, very low on fuel. As he's coming in there with a drip of fuel left in the tank. Here we go. The refueling has been done. The tyres have been done. This is suspension. Go, 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 go! I think we've got ahead of Heemsoth. Who's this ahead of us? We've got another car ahead of us here. Who's that? Who is that? Sundin! I've completely screwed. cow bag, what's wrong with you?
I don't believe it. I don't bloody believe it.
It happened on the last race. It happened on the last race in this particular Grand Prix. It happened to Valdez in Milan. It's now happened to Sundin. I do not believe it. I do not believe it. This has been a catastrophic race for... a catastrophic race for Phoenix Knights. It is... I mean, to be quite honest with you, you could almost argue, well, it happened to Valdez last time, it's now happened to Sundin, they're even Stevens, you know what I mean? I said I didn't do it on purpose, that's for sure. I do not believe this. Come on, Valdez! If you win this race, you've rescued something from this catastrophe! Push hard! I don't give a crap about the temperatures, just go for it, lad! Come on! We've got to do it! We've got to do it! There's two laps to go! We've got to get a race victory out of this. We've got to do. He's probably laughing behind the wheel. Sundin's, what's happened to Sundin, you say? She's run out of fuel? Oh my God, what are you... Couldn't have happened to a nicer girl, he thinks. Couldn't have happened to a nicer girl. Right, is he now, and that might give him the impetus he needs to push harder. Come on! So there's a lesson to be learned, folks, isn't there? Don't play this game when you've just woken up. Because it completely and utterly screws you over. And Valdez is gaining. But there's only one lap to go. He powers down towards the chicane. He's very close. We're going to get a stretch of straight here. Go, 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 go. Shut up. Put your foot down, Valdez. Come on. He's in first position. Last lap. Come on. The track is sopping wet through. It's not intermediate weather now, it's wet weather, but nobody has wet tyres on. Valdez is pushing to the end. He's got to go on to medium because of the fuel. Not got enough fuel. Just manage the gap, Valdez. Manage the gap. He himself isn't pushing either. We're coming round the last few corners. Go into high. There we go. Turn the beeps up a slight touch. Okay, we're sweeping round the penultimate corner now. We just have the chicane to manoeuvre. Track is extremely damp. We don't want to be pushing too hard and risk spinning off. But here we go, as Valdez, despite having to fix his suspension, has crossed the line in first place. He's rescued something for Phoenix Knights after a catastrophic blunder has put Sundin in 15th position. She will not be happy. And when you say thundering Sundin, this might be the first time in the season that she lives up to her name, because she's going to have a face like thunder when she meets up with her pit crew. She is siving through the field slightly, but there's no way she's going to get any points. Oh my God. She remains calm. Just look at that. No expletives, no swearing, no carrying on. She just says, let's put this behind us and move forward. It's all we can do. How does she remain so calm in such a situation? I do not know. Compared to Valdez, when this happened to him in the Italian Grand Prix last time, he upturned a few tables. Was not a happy bunny. But today, the boot is on the other foot, as Valdez picks up the race victory, and even more importantly for the championship, Sundin picks up no points for the first time this season, I think. So Valdez has gained 10 points in the Drivers' Championship. He continues to be on the charge. And has he forced the mistake out of their race mechanics? Is he forcing their hand? Is he putting the pressure on? Could well be. The champion is beginning to look like a champion for the first time this season. He himself got second. He did push us hard. But Valdez would like to tell us that he had his number. He always had it under control. You know what I mean? I had time to fix my suspension, for goodness sake. I'd always had it under control. I'm far faster than he himself. Antonov in third. Salvaged something for Ruiz Motorsport. Mello for the silver racing in fourth. Messalella in fifth. And Gerard pipped the last points position. Well done, Mr. Valdez. Sundin's going to need a lot of cars to have a legal pass to get anything out of this. I think one car's lost some places due to an illegal part. Oh boy. Look at that. Valdez, race victory number 3. Get in, son. I know there's a few Valdez fans out there. Look at that. Oh, look at that. The tables are turning. Sundin is still top, but only by 9 points. One more screw up and Valdez will pounce. She was so far ahead. How has this happened? Antonov, well, the rest of them are way behind. Forget anybody else at this point. It's all about Sundin against Valdez. Two teammates that don't like each other. Valdez is more open about it. He doesn't care who knows. And I think this all gamesmanship. This all rivalry nonsense, telling people that he can't work with this. He's trying to get in ahead. And I think it's working. I really do. He's playing it like a champion. He's playing it like a champion, I'm telling you. The mind games and everything. He's playing it like a champion. Sometimes it's not about what you do on the track. It's sometimes off the track you can get into your opponent's mind. Phoenix Knights, we've got this under control. Forget that. Forget the points. Forget the points. It's all about these last two races. Valdez v. Sundin. All I can flaming do is try and make sure that I give them both a fair crack at the whip. Which means not making silly blunders like forgetting to fuel them. But to be fair, it's happened to both of them once, so it's kind of 50-50. It's even Stevens now, so just got to be on the ball next session, and I certainly won't be recording it when I've just woken up. Right, personality, it's giving an extra boost. The morale's there. He is on cloud number 9. He's only 9 points behind with 2 races to go. If he wins both of those races, depending on what Sundin does, he may be champion. Right, I'm going to have to rush off now. So enjoy your weekend, what's left of it, and I'll see you in the next session. See you soon.